Anyone who has seen the first video of our chassis series knows now how a shock absorber is constructed and which adjustment options are available. If you haven't seen that video yet, you should do so. You can find the link in the video description. For everyone else, we'll continue in this video with the settings of the shock absorber. How do I get a chassis to work properly? How do I set it correctly? And of course, we also want to focus on the theory, so that you also know why the whole thing is working like it is. First of all, we start with a setting that is always perceived to be very misleading, where I also have made countless mistakes myself, although it is actually very easy – the spring preload. Here we have a scooter that has SIP shock absorbers installed at the front and rear. They have an adjustment for the spring preload. And here I can demonstrate to you very well how it all works. The purpose of adjusting the spring preload is not to adjust the hardness of the chassis. This is very important, because that's a common mistake. Don't adjust it if you want a harder chassis. It is only used to adjust the height of the scooter. Because it's possible that a 50 kg lady sits on such a scooter, for example, or maybe a 60 kg Jasko, two completely different loads. And in each case, the chassis should have the same height. Why? Firstly, so that the geometry is retained, and secondly, so that the ratio of positive spring deflection to negative spring deflection is always correct, and the chassis can run well. Keyword: negative spring deflection. I haven't explained that yet, so let's talk about it briefly at the flip chart. The negative spring deflection helps to keep the vehicle calm and steady in every driving situation. So we'll have here another completely exaggerated situation. It's our curb again. This spring is fully tensioned and is completely at the bottom, and I'm driving on the road. If I had no negative spring deflection, the moment I drive over this edge, my tire would lose connection to the road and drop. So in this whole area here, I'd have no grip. That would also be quite uncomfortable again. That's why there is negative spring deflection. The spring is set soft enough so that the scooter compresses it slightly, even in relaxed condition. Then I'll drive down the street again. I'm reaching the obstacle and the tire still has enough room to go down and keep contact with the road. Then the body slowly follows and we can drive on. Back to the scooter. As you can see, I quickly exchanged the PX against our small construction here. This is a tubular construction with a shock absorber or a strut hanging onto it. If I pull on it, then everything moves a little and I can measure how far. So, why the whole thing? I have just explained to you that you can use this union nut to adjust the height of the chassis, or adjust the negative spring deflection. There is a very persistent myth that my chassis will get harder if I change the settings here. From an emotional standpoint, that is somehow understandable, because what do we perceive as hardness? One could say the force I need to compress the shock absorber. The stronger it is, the harder it is, and if I have such a shock absorber in my hand, then I can compress it further, of course. If the nut is all the way down, then if it is at the top. Based on that definition, it would be hardness. But why the spring preload has nothing to do with the hardness of the chassis at all? That I would like to explain now. As you can see, I have already prepared a diagram that's supposed to represent a spring characteristic. This is weight in kilograms, and this is spring deflection in millimeters. So that means, if a 50 kg driver sits on the scooter, the spring will be compressed by 40 mm. For any fictional, rather heavy driver, who weighs 100 kg, it's compressed by 80 mm. I think that's quite easy to understand so far. But what I wanted to show you is, how much a spring is compressed depends on the weight of the driver. I have another sketch of a strut here.
von einem Federbein. Und ich sag mal, ich habe hier die
I drew the length of the spring here. Let's say it's 200 millimeters long. Now a 100 kilogram driver sits on the strut and it's compressed by 80 millimeters. That means it is still 120 millimeters long, right? Millimeters for the heavy guy. What happens if I adjust this lower ring that I use to set my spring preload? Let's say I turn this ring from 200 millimeters to 180 millimeters. Then you can see that there is still a difference here to the 120 millimeters. And if the 100 kilogram driver would sit on the strut again, the spring would also compress to 120 millimeters again. The same thing happens if I screw this ring up even further, to around 40 millimeters, for example. Then I'm at 160 millimeters. If the 100 kilogram guy sits on the strut again, then the spring will compress to 120 millimeters again. That means the spring is always the same length, no matter what I do down here, if the same driver with a weight of 100 kilograms sits on the strut. Now, of course, the big question remains, what did I just adjust? This, the distance between the lower ring and the circle. If the spring always remains the same length and I have adjusted this distance from the lower spring bearing for about 4 centimeters, plus the 120 millimeters of the spring, then my strut is 4 centimeters longer in the loaded state. That means when the 100 kilogram driver is sitting on the scooter. My scooter has risen 4 centimeters. And at the same time, I have determined another dimension from this 120 millimeters to the rebounded spring deflection, namely what the shock absorber can rebound, my negative spring deflection. A lot of theory, very bulky, and whether this is all correct, that we'll check now. Here at our experimental setup, I can show you that quite well. Here is the shock absorber. Here we have a long lever. These are 20 kilograms. Quite a light rider, to be honest, but that's enough with the long lever. And if I pull here, I can show you that very nicely. With the current setting, I have a lot of positive spring deflection, that means downwards, and relatively little negative spring deflection, that means upward. Now I'll measure how long our spring is. It is 150 millimeters long. Next, I'll measure the height of our provisional vehicle, 54 centimeters. Our spring preload is set almost to the max, and now I'm turning it all the way down. As you can see, I just screwed a lot and adjusted the spring preload. I think that should be around 3 centimeters. And now I'll measure what has changed in the height of my vehicle. Now it's almost exactly at 51 centimeters. Before, it was at 54 centimeters. So the vehicle came down 3 centimeters. But how has the length of the spring changed? The spring length is still 150 millimeters. Nothing has changed. What's still interesting is how the negative spring deflection has changed. Well, I don't think I need to measure this. It's way longer than before. As we have just been able to show, by changing the height of the spring preload, we changed the height of the chassis. And we changed the ratio of positive to negative spring deflection. What we did not change was the length of the spring, and thus the hardness. Now I'll show you in a little experiment that the hardness of the chassis really doesn't change. How do you define the hardness of a chassis? The hardness is defined by how deep it sinks in if a weight X is applied. In our case, we will now add 20 kilograms and check how much the chassis sinks in. Then we adjust the spring preload here and do the same thing again. We measure once with the current weight and once with 20 kilograms more. And then we compare whether it has sunk in deeper in one of the two cases. We currently have a height of 50.5 centimeters. Okay, let's apply another 20 kilogram. 49.5 centimeters. So the chassis has sunk in by a centimeter. Let's remove the weights. I have increased the spring preload to max now. Let's check how high the starting position is. Almost exactly 53 centimeters. Now I add another 20 kilogram. After that, I compare again how much the height has changed. Now the height is 52 centimeters, which means that with 20 kilograms more, the undercarriage has now sunk by 1 centimeter. When I had the spring preload all the way down, we had exactly the same result. With 20 kilograms more, the chassis sunk by 1 centimeter. That means in both positions of the spring preload, almost completely down and almost completely up, we have exactly the same result, and the hardness of the chassis is also the same. Our experiment has shown how the spring preload works and the effects it triggers. Next, we're going to show you how to set it correctly at the scooter itself. Before I get the scooter on the hoist, I would like to clear up one last question. Many of you may think that everything I'm talking about sounds quite nice, with my experimental setup and all the theory, but that they can tell themselves if the chassis is harder or softer when they just adjusted the spring preload and sit down on the scooter. I think the official test for that still looks something like this. But what do I test when I do that? I only test the negative spring deflection, because the negative spring deflection is the spring deflection to the top when I sit down on my scooter. So this one, up here. And when I put this plate up, I have a little negative spring deflection. When I put it down, I have a lot of negative spring deflection. And of course, that one feels softer when I sit down. This is why we have different feelings of hardness when you adjust the spring preload. For my adjustments, I don't need much. In principle, I only need a measuring tape. Now in our case for the SIP shock absorbers, there is an extra nice adjustment tool for the spring preload and the scope of delivery, and a small Allen key for the grub screw that keeps the whole thing in place. In some cases, it makes sense to have something with you to place marks. I've picked up a couple of stickers for that. First, I'll measure it in a relaxed state, so that I have a value for reference. This is pretty easy at the front wheel of a Vespa, because I can put it on its main stand, so the front wheel is completely free. The markings are also relatively easy. Just use this screw as a mark here and this axis center point. I'll measure that. From the bottom edge of the screw to the center of the axis is 23 centimeters. I have to do the same at the rear, but it's a little more difficult to get a reference value there. That's why I need the stickers or something else to place a marking. It's still easier than on a motorcycle though, because it makes sense to measure from the shift lever to the side panel. Here I have pretty much the center of the axis, and with a small sticker or a non-permanent pen, I can place a small mark where I measure. But I'm going to demonstrate the whole thing to you at the front, because it's much easier to see there. With a Vespa, the front and rear work the same, but in the front we can see the damper better. What's next? I have to determine a value in the loaded state. Ideally, you always have an assistant for this. First of all, I take the scooter off the main stand. Next, we have to measure the loaded condition, and of course, ideally with the driver who will also drive the scooter later. Of course, he should also sit in the driving position. Not in the back, nor hands-free, but in the position in which he's actually driving. However, when I'm sitting on the scooter, I can hardly measure. So, please give a big applause to our assistant Victor. Victor is now measuring the same positions that I measured earlier. First, I have to get my feet up and get into driving position. 20.5 centimeters. That means the shock absorber sinks by 2.5 centimeters when I sit on it. Well, What does that mean now? What is the correct value? The big problem is that the common rule is that shock absorbers should sink about 25 to 30% between the completely relaxed state and the loaded state, means when the driver is sitting on it. Unfortunately, this is a value that you can basically throw in the garbage can when it comes to scooters, which is simply due to the fact that the spring deflection is shorter and the weight ratios are completely different. But you can say a very good reference value are always 2 centimeters. We just had 2.5 centimeters. That means I have to adjust it a bit here to get to the 2 centimeters. Let's test again. Victor, please. 21.5 centimeters. 21.5. That means we now have 1.5 centimeters. That was a little too much. It's roughly in the range I'm looking for. But I'll adjust it again one more time and show you again how it looks.
Und zeige euch nochmal, wie das jetzt aussieht.
21. 21 centimeters. Exactly 2 centimeters. Thank you, Victor. The spring preload on the front shock absorber should now be correctly adjusted, and I'm going to do the same at the rear. That was a lot of input on the spring, hardness, height, and so on. But such a shock absorber still consists of several parts, including the damper. And how to adjust that one correctly, that I would like to tell you in the next video. I hope you enjoyed it today. I hope it was informative and that you've learned something. If so, subscribe to our channel, activate the bell, and tune in next time when we talk about how to set the rebound and compression levels correctly.